So in the previous lecture, I discussed the point-by-point Gauss-Seidel method. Now, as I said, that method has certain disadvantages. One of the disadvantages that we saw was that the method in itself was slow to converge to the actual solution. And I said that the boundary condition, it happens because the boundary condition information is transmitted very slowly through the domain. Now the reason for that, just to clarify, is that if you think of it, let's say we are at this point I comma j, then it doesn't see the boundary node in itself, but rather the penultimate node actually will see the boundary. So the boundary condition can only reach this point in one time step. In the second iteration, or in the first iteration, in the second iteration, that propagates to the interior and then it goes further. So you can see that with each iterative process, the boundary condition actually goes inwards. So that makes it very slow, because remember, at the end of the day, it's a boundary condition which are actually dictating the solution to a given problem. Now the other option is to use line by line method, which I'll discuss today, which is also an improvement over the conventional point by point Gauss-Seidel method. In this method, the way this method works is slightly different, and we will exploit an earlier algorithm in this method. What we'll do is we'll first choose a line, and I mean a grid line in this case. So let's say the y direction, and let me define my axis here. So let's say I choose the y direction where the neighboring values are known from the previous iteration, and I'll say what is meant by previous iteration. Now previous iteration would mean that these are the latest values. This basically means that these are the latest values stored with us. So in this case, if I choose a y direction, which I am now showing here by this line here, so this is the y direction along which I decide to solve my system. So I would use the neighboring values. Let's say at this point ij, the values i minus 1j and i plus 1j would be whatever is stored in the memory at this current time, and that is what I'm calling as latest values. Now what I will do is I will solve for the variable along the chosen line. Let's say the variable here is t, temperature, or it could be velocity or velocity component, let's say u. So I will solve for that dependent variable along this chosen line by using the tri-diagonal matrix algorithm in a heat or in a conduction type problem. Now why did I do this, or why am I proposing this? Because I know that TDMA, or the Thomas algorithm, is one technique in which you can actually get a direct solution of the entire row, or in this case this entire, you know, coordinate, the points along this specific x coordinate, in one shot. Now this I will do. So once I have done this for the variable along a chosen line by TDMA, which I said is a direct solution process, I can follow this procedure for all lines in one direction. Now in this case, what I mean by that is that I can keep doing this for every successive line. So if I'm doing it at this, along this line, I'm applying TDMA along this line, I can then apply TDMA along this line, and then TDMA along this line, fully knowing that once I'm applying TDMA, let's say along this line, the values which have been calculated along this line are going to be used as knowns when I frame the TDMA for this line. Now we can also repeat this procedure for lines in other directions. So what I can also do is, once I have swept along y, or I have solved along y, I can then solve along x by the same procedure. Now this method can be very easily applied to 2D or 3D or 3D problems. And with respect to the 2D heat conduction equation, if we write that, we would have Ti plus 1j minus 2Tij plus Ti minus 1j by delta x square plus Tij plus 1 minus 2Tij plus Tij minus 1 by delta y square is 0. Now, since I cannot solve this, you know, by direct methods, we can, and we are going to use an iterative process. So let me say that I'm going to use TDMA along y direction. So then I would say these are at k plus 1, these are the values that I'm going to solve using TDMA. And I know that ti plus 1j would be stored from the last iteration. So I'm going to say that is from iteration k. Tij is what I'm going to determine in this iteration. So I put it at k plus 1. And ti minus 1j would be from the current iteration number, but from the previous line. And again, using, let's say, beta to be delta x by delta y, I could write that the equation that I'm going to solve in the TDMA will be beta square ti j minus 1 at k plus 1 minus 2 1 plus beta square ti j k plus 1 plus ti j plus 1 k plus 1, in fact, beta square ti j plus 1 k plus 1 would be equal to minus ti plus 1 j k minus ti minus 1 j k plus 1. Now note that the three unknowns in this problem are, or in this equation, are these. The other two on the right hand side are known, so that is the reason I've taken them on the other side, and I can now apply TDMA to solve this. So what we are doing is, we are doing a mixture of Gauss-Seidel and a direct solution process. So we are exploiting this aspect that TDMA can be easily applied along the y direction in these cases, or again even in the x direction, but I'm saying y for now. So we can easily apply a TDMA there, but at the same time, since we don't know the temperatures on the neighboring points, we use it from the current iteration level. And so we have sort of mixed both TDMA and Gauss-Seidel. So this is definitely faster, because boundary condition or boundary information from the ends is transmitted at once to the interior of the domain. So that would be an advantage. So we say convergence is faster because boundary information is transmitted. When I say, I'm going to say at once would mean that in one shot, which would mean in one solution of the linear equations to the interior of the domain. But a sort of a downside, which I would not say is a downside, but rather, you know, one aspect that needs to be addressed, is that the rate of transmission of information in the other direction is similar to a point by point method. What I mean by information here is, of course, boundary conditions. And I'm saying it's similar because these temperatures here that I have shown, these temperatures here that we have, are actually being used from the current iteration level. And we are not using anything to solve them out, because we're just, let's say, if we are only taking or setting up TDMA along one direction, then we're not applying, or we're allowing this boundary condition to propagate in the same way that the point by point Gauss-Seidel generally does. Now, an obvious remedy for this problem is that we can use alternating directions, so that we can first apply TDMA along these directions and then we can apply TDMA along these directions. So there is no preferential treatment given, and also it can also lead to bringing in information much more quickly into the bulk. So to show you this, let me take a specific problem. And of course, the reason I'm saying this is that even when we sweep, or even if we do this kind of process that we choose one direction or one coordinate and we go from one boundary to another boundary by setting up the TDMA problem there, it may not seem very important, but the sweep direction is also very important in some cases. So let me show you what I mean by that. Let's say that we are solving a problem that looks like this. Let's say we have a rectangular domain which has the following boundary conditions. Let's say this is adiabatic and we have a given temperature, let's say T2 on one end. We have t equal to t1 and t equal to t1 on two boundaries. And now we want to say, how do we solve this using line by line method? Now, in this problem, it is easy to see, and I hope you see this, that the left to right sweep will be much more beneficial than the right to left. First thing is, going from left to right would mean that we bring in this temperature all the way in. Since this boundary is adiabatic, it is not going to give us a reference temperature in the problem. But having sweeping from this side will actually give us a known temperature going all the way into the boundary, especially when we're solving this iteratively. Second thing is that the known temperature also gives us some handle of the scale of the problem, because in this case the two temperatures on the other ends are constants. So if I were to do a sweep along, let's say, this direction, along the y direction, you can see that sweeping along this direction will actually not give me substantial changes. And why is that? It is because the two ends are at the same temperatures. So heat conduction along this will actually be marginal. What we expect is heat conduction along this direction. So sweep direction is also important in cases, and it also becomes important in convection problems where a sweep from upstream to downstream is known to produce much faster convergence. So to summarize, sweep direction is important in some cases, and that we do by visual examination of the boundary conditions. And in convection problems, a sweep from upstream to downstream would produce much faster convergence. And that is because the information is known to flow downhill, so we are going to have the conditions, the upstream conditions, going down in the direction where the flow is taking it. So I would now like to talk about another aspect, which is on over relaxation and under relaxation in any iterative scheme. So note that it's often desirable to speed up or slow down changes from iteration to iteration depending on the problem that we are working with. So for instance, it is often required to speed up or accelerate the iteration process to achieve a converged solution in a minimum number of iterations. Now this is often used in Gauss-Seidel, and this method is what we will call as successive over relaxation, or as I will say, SOR. Similarly, it's also sometimes important or required to slow down the rate of convergence. The slowing down will be what we'll call as under relaxation, and it is often employed, or we'll see that in practice it is often done to avoid divergence in nonlinear equations. Now what do these actually mean? So let me show you by an example or by an illustration. Let's work with the discretized equation that I could write in any general system as AP TP to be summation ANB TNB plus B, where P becomes a point I comma J, or I comma J comma K, or in 1D it just becomes I, and T and B are all neighbors that depend on the discretization scheme that we choose. So the kind of stencil that we describe, that basically will bring out all contributions from neighbor points, and B are any constants that appear in the equation. Now say TP star, let's say, is the value of the TP from last iteration. So this is value from last iteration. Now note that I can, using TP star, I can rewrite this equation in a very specific form. So what I can do is I can say TP could be written as, which, and remember, I'm trying to get the solution, the converged solution to this problem. So I could write this as summation A and B T and B plus B by AP, which is what TP will be, in the sense, and the solutions are exactly satisfied. But let me say I'm going to subtract TP star here and add TP star to it. Now the reason I'm writing it this way is that in the iteration process, this value is actually what is a guess, or the last known value for this equation, and this number in the brackets or in the parentheses now actually is the change that we see in a given iteration. So let's say in the current iteration, this will be delta TP that we will see. So I can say this is delta TP. So the essential idea of any successive over relaxation or any over relaxation or under relaxation is that we modify the change and we incorporate a fraction of the change in the guessed value, which is TP star. So the total change that I'm going to now say could be written as TP, let's say the new value in the new iteration would be TP star plus some fraction into, or a number into summation ANB TNB plus B by AP minus TP star, where I can rearrange this equation and also write this as, so I can write TP new as TP star into 1 minus omega plus omega TP, where I note that TP is this number and this omega multiplies with this TP star, and so we get 1 minus omega here. Now note that, without, before I say anything about the value of omega, note that the, as iterations converge, so as we are going along within it in the iteration process, as our iterations converge, TP will actually be nearly the same as TP star, let's say on convergence, because that will be the criteria that we will use in any iteration process. We are trying to attain some kind of situation where the residual starts going to zero. The residual here will mean the relative difference between TP and TP star. Now, if this was to happen, our equation A actually also indicates that the converged value of T will satisfy the original discretized equation. Note that if TP was equal to TP star, right, which would mean that, you know, this value will actually go to zero, and so this is what we are actually attaining, moving towards. We are saying the new value should actually be equal to TP star. The reason it works is because this, we're multiplying omega by the delta change. So as the change becomes zero, or nearly zero, in the limit that the change becomes zero, the converged solution remains as the same as the last known solution. So this aspect, that the converged value of T also satisfies the original discretized equation, is actually a key property of a legitimate relaxation solution, relaxation scheme. So this is a property of a legitimate relaxation scheme. If a relaxation scheme is such where this cannot be maintained, and this equation A that we are writing, in that sense the relaxation equation that we are writing, does not give us that outcome, then it's not a legitimate relaxation scheme. Now, what does omega actually mean in terms of its values? Note that if omega is greater than 0 and less than 1, then we'll call this as under relaxation. And it's easy to see now why I'm calling it as under relaxation, because if omega is less than 1, we are actually adding a smaller portion than the change itself. So we're adding a portion. So we, in the old iteration number, or in the old iteration value, we're adding a change, an increment, which is smaller than that actually predicted by this number. So we are basically taking a smaller step. So it's like saying that if I think of it this way, if TP star was here and TP is this what is predicted, we are actually saying that the out of the total change, which is delta TP, we only add maybe omega delta TP. So we don't get, so we jump only this much and not that much. Now in this case, in the case of under relaxation, clearly TP new will be closer to TP star. The other range of omega or the other regime would be where omega is more than 1 and I would say less than 2 typically. Very rarely do we see omega crossing the number 2. Now this will be over relaxation. Now in this case, it's easy to see that over relaxation would mean that we are now jumping far ahead. So we are actually trying to accelerate. If you look at this equation now, you are saying take the twice of this new value minus, because omega is going to be more than 1, so minus the old value. And if you rearrange, you can actually see that it's more, it's accelerating based on the value of TP that is currently stored in our or that is currently predicted by the solution of the linear algebraic equations. Now what about the optimum value of omega? Because that is also needed to be, we need to say something about it before we close this discussion. So what will be the typical or the recommended value of the relaxation factor? Now this depends on a variety of factors, and when I say typical value, I'm talking of, let me put this way, the optimum value. So this depends on the nature of the problem. Nature of the problem would mean that it could be a linear problem, non-linear problem, or it could be a diffusion problem or an advection diffusion problem, which also actually came in the category of linear and non-linear problems, but just to illustrate in this course what we are doing. The second is, it depends on the grid spacing. So it is not the same optimum irrespective of the grid that you choose. So for a coarser grid, you may have a different optimum omega, and for a finer grid, we may have a different optimum omega. When I also talk about optimum omega, I'm also talking about omega that gives us the fastest convergence to the actual solution. So optimum value, when I talk about, I'm actually talking about a situation which gives fastest convergence to the solution. The third aspect that this depends on is on the iterative procedure. Now, iterative procedure would mean that pertaining to this current lecture that we are doing, iterative procedure will actually mean that whether you are solving by the point by point Gauss-Seidel method or the line by line, in both cases the optimum omega will actually be definitely different. The last thing that you need to understand is that omega does not have to be a number which needs to be a constant from iteration to iteration. It can actually be changed. So omega need not be a constant from iteration to iteration. However, it is not very convenient to choose a different value of omega for each grid point. And that's obvious why I'm saying this, because if you really knew which grid point should actually use, or very rarely do we know based on the geometry, where you need or where you can have a higher omega as compared to other locations, or where you may need maybe under relaxation, low omega as compared to other problems. And the reason I spoke about omega not being a constant is that sometimes, in certain problems, we may actually start with the, we may have to start with some form of under relaxation to stabilize the problem so that we don't get any stability issues, but at some point we can actually then accelerate and go for over relaxation so that omega then can actually be varied depending on our understanding of the problem.